through a rectangular waveguide. And to summarize what we have discussed, waveguide modes are nothing but the possible solutions to wave equation. Okay, we have to solve the wave equation in a bounded region, bounded by the walls of the metallic waveguide. So subject to the boundary conditions imposed by these metallic walls, we have solved the wave equation and we got a number of solutions for that. So each solution represents a particular electromagnetic field configuration which can propagate through that particular guide. Okay, so that way we have infinitely large number of solutions, mathematical solutions we get in the bounded region, and of course those solutions which satisfy the boundary conditions, they represent certain field configurations which can propagate through the guide. So waveguide modes are nothing but the possible solutions to wave equation. In fact, when we try to solve wave equation in a bounded region, we get infinite number of solutions satisfying the boundary conditions. Each such solution represents a particular electromagnetic field configuration that can propagate along that particular guide and is termed a mode. Okay, so how many such modes will propagate in a guide? Actually, that is determined by the relative size of the guide with respect to wavelength of the signal. Compared to the wavelength of the signal that is propagating in a particular guide, compared to that wavelength, what is the size of the waveguide, physical dimensions of the waveguide? Okay, depending on that ratio, okay, or the on that relationship, the number of modes which can propagate in a particular guide, because each mode has its own cutoff frequency. Okay, so at that frequency, how many modes are the signal can propagate in by means of how many modes rather? Okay, the total power that we feed into a waveguide, that will be distributed into the different modes. If there is only one mode propagating, then entire power is carried by that particular mode only. Otherwise, if two modes are propagating at that frequency, the signal that we are, the power that you are feeding into the guide, that gets distributed between these two modes. Say, I'll just give a crude example. Suppose we get down from the train in a railway station, and your luggage may be just carried by a single porter. All your luggage is being carried by one single porter. Okay, that is one case that is corresponding to one mode. Otherwise, suppose if you have three bags, let us say your luggage, total luggage consists of three bags, and if three porters carry these three bags, one each, that means your total luggage is not carried by one person, it is now carried by three persons. And at the other end, when you, after you come out of the railway station, you have to collect your baggage from three persons. Okay, so the your baggage load is now being distributed, or rather was distributed among those porters. So similarly, the number, if more number of modes propagate, that means the total power, okay, is now shared between these different modes. Okay, so how many such modes will propagate in a guide is determined by the relative size of the guide with respect to the wavelength. Now, so the larger the guide, the more will be the number of propagating modes, and each mode will have its own cutoff frequency. Now, in a given guide, a particular mode will propagate only when the frequency is above a particular limit. Thus, the mode having the lowest cutoff frequency is called the dominant mode, and it requires the minimum size of the guide for its propagation compared to any other mode. Okay, so these are the basic concepts that we understood in the previous semester class. Okay. waveguide propagation. Okay, so basically we also understood that because each mode has its own cutoff frequency and the dominant mode has the lowest cutoff frequency, below that particular frequency no signal can propagate, or the signal cannot propagate in any fashion through that guide. Okay, above that particular frequency, so the dominant mode starts propagating first and other modes slowly will come later as the frequency is increased. So basically a waveguide is a high pass filter. This is what we have understood. And then each propagating mode is characterized by its own cutoff frequency, by its own phase constant, by its own phase velocity, by its own guide wavelength, and by its own characteristic wave impedance. Okay, these things we have seen. Okay, now am I clear? Is it okay? Shall we go ahead? Yeah. Right. So now, we have written the expression for the guide wavelength as lambda g is equal to lambda by 1 minus lambda by lambda c whole square. So for a given mode, what is the cutoff wavelength, and it based on that, at a given wavelength, free space wavelength, in that particular guide, the guide wavelength in the guide, in the direction of propagation, or in the z direction, that is given by this expression. And from this expression you can also understand that lambda g is greater than the free space wavelength at that particular frequency. Okay, lambda g is greater than the free space wavelength at the given frequency. Okay, now we have gamma is equal to h square minus omega square mu epsilon square root of that. Okay, so for frequencies below the cutoff frequency, this quantity, okay, will be small compared to h square, and gamma will be real, and that means alpha is given by this one. Okay, so the moment you say you have alpha, that means the signal gets attenuated. So once omega is more than frequency is above cutoff frequency, gamma becomes imaginary and there is no attenuation, alpha becomes zero. So for the assumed perfect conductors and lossless dielectric. Okay, since the conductors are perfect conductors and the dielectric is a lossless dielectric, and there is no attenuation, and then the wave will be able to propagate without any attenuation above the cutoff frequency. This is the ideal situation. Okay, but though we have assumed infinite conductivity or perfect conductor, that is infinite conductivity for the conductor, but in practice, whether we use copper, aluminium or brass, though the conductivity is very high, but it is not infinite. Okay, so the conductivity is finite, though it is quite large. So due to finite conductivity, the conductor will have some loss, is going to have very small loss. Okay, of course, as far as the dielectric is concerned, if we assume air as the dielectric inside the waveguide, okay, then dielectric loss will not be there, but due to the finite conductivity of the walls, there is going to be some loss. Okay, now the point is the field amplitudes depend on the loss. Okay, and loss again depends on the field amplitude, so it is a closed circuit. Okay, then how do we find what is the loss in a practical guide? okay, how do we find the loss in a practical guide? Okay, so we have to break this circle somewhere and enter into the circle. So for that matter, what we do is, as we have just discussed, we assume perfect conductors and derive the expressions for the fields. Okay, assume the perfect conductor situation, we derive the fields, okay, expressions for the fields. So using these fields, okay, we find the surface currents due to the tangential component of the magnetic field, the due to the component of the magnetic field that is tangential to the four walls, okay, and then based on that you determine the surface current that is flowing through the conductors. And then now you assume, at this point we assume that the conductor has certain surface resistance, okay, we assume that the conductor has a certain surface resistance. Now what is the loss? The conduction current JS, surface current JS, is flowing through the surface of a conductor which has a surface resistance RS, okay. So from that we can find out the loss, JS squared into RS, that will give you the power loss due to the finite conductivity of the walls and due to the currents which we have obtained assuming perfect conductor, okay. That is how this problem will be solved, okay. Now so let us see what is the loss attenuation in a practical guide. So however, the walls of a practical guide do have some losses, so the attenuation factor in the range of the propagation, okay, above the cutoff, okay, below the cutoff, alpha is a real number, alpha is a real number, and the and it will be a quite large quantity, and the signal will get heavily attenuated, exponentially it will decay, okay. So that is the situation below the cutoff, but above the cutoff, ideally speaking, there is no loss due to the finite conductivity of the wall, okay. So the attenuation factor in the range of propagation is defined as, let us call it alpha dash, okay. Then that is power lost per unit length, okay, power lost per unit length divided by 2 times the power transmitted, okay. This is the definition of alpha dash, or how we can find out the attenuation constant of a propagating mode in a practical guide, okay. Now so the power, how do you get the power transmitted? The power transmitted is given by integrating the pointing vector, okay, over the cross section of the waveguide. Power is flowing through the waveguide, so pointing vector gives you the power flow per unit area, okay, and then you have the guide. Integrating over the guide dimension cross section, if you integrate the pointing vector, you get the total power flow through the waveguide. So power transmitted is given by integrating the pointing vector. Pointing vector is given by half of, okay, transverse E cross H, okay, in the transverse, E transverse cross H transverse, because 90 degrees, so it becomes simply multiplication. So E transverse into H transverse, half of that, that gives you the average power, okay, average value of the pointing vector looking into the Z direction, okay. So now you integrate this, wave impedance, okay, impedance looking into the Z direction, which is nothing but the ratio of E transverse to H transverse, okay. The ratio of the transverse components of electric and magnetic fields, that will give you the impedance looking into the Z direction. So this is the wave impedance looking into the Z direction, okay. So this can be written as half of ZZ H transverse transverse square magnitude, okay, or otherwise 1 by 2 ZZ into E transverse, okay, square, okay. Is this clear now? Okay, am I clear? Is this clear? Yeah. Right, we'll proceed. Okay, now, so the power transmitted is given by integrating over the cross section, integrating the pointing vector over the cross section, that is total power through the cross section is half of ZZ, integration over the cross section of the waveguide, that is 0 to A and the integral 0 to B H transverse square. Okay, then this is how one has to calculate the power transmitted. Similarly, the power lost per unit length of the guide. Okay, so that is per unit area, how much is the power loss? Okay, that is given by the Js squared Rs. Okay, Js is the surface current density and Rs is the surface resistance. Okay, so multiplication of Js square and Rs will give you the power loss per unit area. And so that integration, that power loss per unit area and over the unit length of the guide, you can calculate the power lost. Of course, this you have to calculate individually for the narrow wall and for the broad wall, because Js depends upon the field and the fields depend upon which wall we are considering. So accordingly, we have to calculate the power lost. Okay. And in all the four walls, what is the power loss per unit area, per unit length of the guide? Okay. So in one narrow wall, you can calculate, and one broad wall, you can calculate, multiply that by two, so that you get the power loss in all the four walls. Okay. So once you get this, using constant, okay, attenuation constant. So for the dominant TE10 mode, okay, for the dominant TE10 mode, that means you take the field expressions for the 10 mode. For the 10 mode, what fields you have? You have the EY component, you have the HX component, and you have the HZ component. Okay, so using these HX and HZ components, okay, you will find the power lost, etc., and then using those fields you find the pointing vector and the power transmitted. Okay, by the, what is the total power transmitted by the dominant mode and what is the power loss due to that, and then using that expression you calculate alpha dash. Okay, so now let us say alpha. Okay, now alpha we mean here it is due to the flow of the currents through the finite conductivity of the walls. So alpha dash, alpha will come out to be so many napers per meter for the TE10 mode. Okay, so it depends upon the surface resistance. Okay, and then of course the dimension B, and then the dimension A, and then the cutoff frequency and the given the propagating frequency, etc. Okay, where this constant K, that is equal to square root of 1 minus MC by F whole square, and surface resistance RS is equal, is given by omega into mu, the mu of the metal, that metallic guide we are using, what is the mu of that metal, what is the conductivity, finite value of the RS, and using this expression, one can calculate the attenuation factor for a given mode. Okay, this is, of course, this is the expression for the TE109. Okay, now what is the quality factor? The quality factor Q, which is closely related to alpha, of course, that is defined by Q is equal to omega by omega into energy stored per unit length divided by the energy lost per unit length per second. Okay, using this expression, of course, we can find out what is the quality factor of the waveguide. And for a waveguide, energy transmitted per second, what is the total energy transmitted per second? That is equal to the guide velocity, group velocity, the group velocity into energy stored per unit length. Okay, so using this expression, one can calculate the energy transmitted per second. Energy stored per unit length will be 1 by Vg into power transmitted, where Vg is called the group velocity. Okay, so of course, we are not going into the details of these parameters. Okay, now if you see the cutoff frequencies, okay, of different modes in a rectangular waveguide, one thing is you can have a rectangular waveguide, say like this. Okay, now what is the dimension of A and what is the dimension of B? B by A is equal to 1 means, it is a square waveguide. Okay, it is a square waveguide. B by A is equal to half means dimension being equal to half of the broad dimension. Okay, B is half of A. Okay, so it is a perfect rectangle, whereas this is a square waveguide. Now, in a rectangular waveguide, okay, what is the dominant mode? The mode having the lowest cutoff frequency, that is the TE109. If we normalize the cutoff frequencies of the other modes, okay, with reference to FC, with reference to FC of 10, we can normalize the cutoff frequencies of the higher modes. Okay, if you see, for a rectangular waveguide with B by A is equal to 1 by 2, because these cutoff frequencies depend upon B by A value. Okay, as far as 10 is concerned, it does not depend on B. Okay, but other modes, okay, other cutoff frequencies 11, 11, okay, 21, 01, etc., they depend on the, okay, for a given condition, TE10 is having the lowest cutoff, and then the next mode, okay, when the frequency is doubled, okay, when the frequency of operation in a particular guide, when the frequency of the signal is doubled, okay, then the TE20 mode will start propagating, and the TE01 mode also will start propagating. So now I'll repeat once again. In a given waveguide, okay, in this particular waveguide, okay, suppose the cutoff frequency of the 10 mode, okay, is, let us say, 5 gigahertz. Just let us say, okay, 5 gigahertz. So as you increase the, when the signal frequency is 3 gigahertz, it cannot propagate in that guide. Okay, when the signal frequency is 4 gigahertz, it cannot propagate in that guide. When the signal frequency comes to 5 gigahertz, as you increase the frequency to 5 gigahertz, it just starts propagating, and above 5 gigahertz, the signal will propagate through that guide in the form of TE10 mode. So the entire power you are giving, okay, whatever power you feed, the total power is propagated in that guide, will propagate in that guide in the TE10 mode, in the TE10 mode. Field patterns only will carry the power, total power. As you keep on increasing the frequency beyond 5 gigahertz, okay, 6 gigahertz, 7 gigahertz, 8 gigahertz, 9 gigahertz, up to 9.9 gigahertz, the total power is carried by the TE10 mode only, because TE20 mode cannot propagate up to this particular point. Okay, when the frequency is increased to 10 gigahertz, okay, that means double of the cutoff of 10. Okay, at 10 gigahertz, and TE01 mode also. These modes also, these patterns also, field patterns also, can start propagating in that particular guide if the frequency is 10 gigahertz. Okay, so now suppose that particular guide, if you feed a signal at 10 gigahertz or more than 10 gigahertz, let us say 11 gigahertz, okay, then the total power you are feeding now is shared between the 10 mode, 20 mode, and 01 mode. All the three modes will be able to will propagate, and the total power input power is shared between all the three modes. That is the concept. Okay, so and suppose if you further increase the frequency, okay, if you use that particular guide at, let us say, 15 gigahertz at a much higher frequency, then these things also will come into picture. All the five modes will propagate, and all the five modes will share the total power. Okay, because of this, you will have difficulty at the other end. You will have difficulty at the other end, because if only one mode propagates, your entire power is in this mode, and if you tap the if you can couple at the other end, if you can couple to this, your coupling mechanism is such that it can couple to this mode, it can extract power from that mode, that is enough, you will get back all the total power. Okay, otherwise what happens, suppose if three modes are propagating, okay, you feed 10 watts of power, let us say 5 watts is carried by this, and another 2 watts is carried by this, let us say 3 watts is carried by this, so total power, get the total power back, what you have to do, your coupling mechanism should be such that it can extract power from this mode, and from this mode also. Otherwise, you cannot get the total power back. So, like the porter example, unless you collect the luggage from all the porters, okay, you will not get back your total luggage. Otherwise, you will miss some of your luggage. Okay, so it is also like that. So, for this reason, what we do is, okay, we normally prefer to have only one mode in a given guide at a given frequency. At the operating frequency, we want only one mode to propagate. Okay, so is it clear now? Suppose if this particular guide, okay, if it is operated from this frequency up to this frequency only, not here, okay, slightly less than this frequency. So within that range, you will have only problem, and there are so many other advantages of this one. Okay, right. So if you see the attenuation characteristic, okay, of the different modes, okay, now here this is a guide of 2 inch, a dimension is 2 inch, and b dimension is 1 inch, okay, or one, it's not 1 inch, okay, it can be a variable one. Okay, suppose if b by a is 1/10, that means this is only 0.2 inch, this is 0.2, this is 2, so b by a is 1/10. Okay, b by a is half, okay, that means this is 1 inch. Suppose b by a is 1, okay, that means this also is 2 inch. Okay, it becomes a square wave. Okay, so now in a guide like this, okay, depending on the b by a ratio, if you see the if you see TE10, okay, let us say rectangular waveguide, B by A is equal to half, okay, in that the TE10 attenuation is like this, okay, the TE10 attenuation is like this. Okay, of course this TM11 has less attenuation, but that is B by A is equal to 1. Okay, if we make B by A1, other modes also will propagate. So we don't want it. Okay, TE 10, okay, B by A half. Now you have B by A half, the same grid, TM 11. Okay, the TM 11 is having a characteristic like this. Okay, so in the B by A is equal to half, these two, TE 10 is attenuation is like this. Okay, and TM 11 attenuation is varying like this with frequency like this. Okay, with frequency like this. So that is the reason the dominant mode, not only it has the lowest cutoff frequency or which starts propagating first, and also it will have less attenuation. Okay, very very small attenuation over a considerable frequency range, and of course afterwards once again it starts increasing, but we use the guide, okay, in that particular frequency range where the attenuation is less. Okay, where the attenuation is less. Another point you can observe here, as you approach the cutoff, okay, as you approach the cutoff frequency, the attenuation is sharply increasing. Okay, so we should not use very close to the cutoff frequency. At if you use just at the cutoff, just above the cutoff frequency, the attenuation will be quite heavy. Okay, and so we should leave some margin, and after that you should start using the guide. You should not use the guide immediately above the cutoff. Near cutoff, the attenuation will be quite heavy. Okay, of course at cutoff the attenuation will go to infinity. Okay, so these are some of the aspects that we should understand. Okay, now you can also see here for the half, B by A is equal to half, these are the modes. Okay, if you increase the width B and make it a square guide, you see other modes are also coming into picture. Okay, here TE 01 and 10, they simultaneously at the same time both will start propagating because the dimension is same in both the directions. Okay, then the TM 11 and TE 11 also will come into picture. Then here, so instead of only one mode in this range, okay, we will have four modes. So we don't want that. That leads to other complications. Okay. Okay, is it clear? So we try to under magnetic field configuration a particular field pattern. Okay, you have number of such patterns which can propagate through that guide depending upon the dimensions of the guide with reference to the wavelength of operation, and we prefer to have only one mode, and the total power in that case, the total power is carried by that particular mode only. And we also have seen the expressions, different expressions for the phase velocity, the characteristic wave impedance, the cutoff frequency, cutoff wavelength, impedance, etc. Okay, all these things. And one more thing, maybe, okay, I'll just do explain you one more point about impedance, and then we will go to the circular wavelengths. Okay. Okay, if you see the expression for the TE mode and TM mode, TE mode and TM mode, these two expressions are different. Okay, these two expressions are different, and you see the behavior of the variation of the impedance with frequency. Okay, this you can take as an assignment, you can try at home, and you try to compare the behavior of this impedance variation with the frequency to, basically now you say waveguide is a high pass filter. Okay, so now you have the high pass filter, you assume a normal high pass filter, and you can construct that in two ways, a pi filter and a T filter. Okay, T section and a P by section in circuits, in lumped elements and in filters, you can have a T section filter and you can have a pi section filter. So you see the impedance variation of the T section lenses and you try to compare these two. Then I come to a conclusion that TM mode will be analogous to one type of filter and TE mode, okay, is analogous to another type of filter. Okay, that comparison you can try to do. Okay, waveguide. Okay, where cylindrical coordinates. Okay, so in this case, the cross section of the guide is circular instead of rectangular. Hence, it is customary to use the cylindrical coordinates to do the analysis. So here, instead of x component, y component, and z component for the fields, what are the components we will have? You will have the rho component, the radial component. You will have the phi component. Okay, you will have the phi component, and of course, you will have the z component. Okay, you will have E rho, E phi, E z. Similarly, you will have H rho, H phi, and H z. Okay, so these things now you can see which one will be tangential to the conducting surface. Okay, EZ or HZ can be tangential to the conducting surface. Similarly, E phi, okay, E phi and H phi also can be tangential to the conducting surface. Okay, of course, E rho and H rho will be normal to the conductor. Okay, so this is the situation here. Okay, now in this case we will have E rho, E phi, E z, and H rho, H phi, H z components for the E and H planes. Of course, the procedure is same. We have to follow the same procedure as in the case of rectangular waveguide. So here I will not go into the details. Okay. We will just briefly I will explain the procedure. Okay, so for TM. Okay, so following the same procedure as in the case of rectangular guide, that is what we did there. Okay, equations in cylindrical coordinates. And then we expressed the transverse fields, okay, in terms of the longitudinal components. So the same thing we will do here also. We express E rho and H rho and E phi and H phi, the transverse components, in terms of the longitudinal components, that is E z and H z. Now we can solve the wave equations for E z and H z and find the two components. And of course, apply the boundary conditions and the tangential components to solve the constants. So the procedure will be same. Only thing is we need to do the entire procedure in cylindrical coordinates, and this is much more. We feel that it will be much more complicated as compared to the rectangular case because we are more familiar with the use of rectangular coordinates. But the procedure is same. Okay. So now for the TM waves, HZ will be zero. Okay, here again, once again, we can classify the fields into two types, the TE type and TM type. HZ is equal to zero means TM type. EZ is equal to zero means TE type. So the same procedure. So let us say for TM waves, HZ will be zero, obvious. Okay, then the other thing, remaining thing is EZ. Okay, so the wave equation in cylindrical coordinates for EZ component will come out to be like this. Okay, And once again, we follow the same procedure as in the case of rectangular waveguide. Assume a product solution that is EZ. Okay, that actually EZ is this one. It's a function. Everything, all the components, X component, Y component, or Z component, whatever component you take, it is a function of all the three coordinates, and it is a function of time. Okay, so here, of course, function of time, e power j omega t, that is implied. Okay, and now it is a function of the three coordinates. In this, what we do in the product solution, we assumed this to be a product of three. Okay. The z variation we assumed e power minus gamma z, and for the rho and phi dependence. So you have a function p which is a function of rho alone, and you have a function q which is a function of phi alone. So the solution is a product of these two and multiplied by e power minus gamma z for the z variation. Okay, so p of rho and q of phi, that is equal to ez dash multiplied by this one. So that is the total ez, of course, including time variation e power j omega t, that is implied. Okay, so where p of rho is a function of rho alone, and q of phi is a function of phi alone. Okay, is this clear? So now substituting these things into this wave equation and separating the variables, and instead of partial differential equations, we get to ordinary differential equations. Okay, we get to ordinary differential equations like this: d squared q to d phi square is equal to minus n q square, where n is some constant, and d square p etc. is equal to zero. This is another equation. Okay, now this the procedure is same as that of rectangular coordinates. Okay, rectangular waveguide. Now the solution for this equation can be written like that. Okay, it is a cos and sine special equation now. So dividing this throughout by h square, and this can be transformed into like this. Okay, the equation 4. Okay, can be transformed into this. Okay, now this is the standard form of the so-called Bessel's equation in terms of rho h. Okay, variable is rho h in terms of rho h. This is in the standard form of a Bessel's equation, and then we need to find the solution for this equation. Okay, so if we this is the Bessel's function of zeroth order, okay, first kind and zeroth order, and of course this is the Bessel function of the second kind. Anyway, that forget about that. Okay, so the different j of course here. Okay, before that this one, this slide will be there. So the possible solution for this equation, okay, p rho as a function of rho h. Okay, the possible solution. Okay. The possible solution for this equation. Okay, the possible solution for this equation is one possible solution is Jn rho h. Okay, so what is this Jn? Here Jn is a Bessel's function or Bessel function of the first kind. This is what is called Bessel function of the first kind of order n. Okay, Bessel function of the first kind of order n. Okay. Now the expression for ez. Now what? How this? We know how a sine function varies, or we know how a cos function varies. Okay, but then what is the variation of this Bessel function? Okay, of the first kind of order n. Okay, that that you can see here. So this is the Bessel function of the first kind zeroth order. This is the Bessel function of the first kind of order 1. This is of order 2. Here, this is also an oscillatory function okay, like the sine wave, but in the case of sine wave, the amplitude does not decrease. It is a harmonically varying function with certain periodicity. Whereas here, this is of course an oscillatory one, but it is a decaying, its amplitude decays, okay. It is a decaying oscillatory function, okay. Except the 0th order, other order Bessel functions, they are starting from zero. They become zero at rho is equal to zero, okay, at the, for the argument equal to zero. Whereas the 0th order one, it is starting at one, okay. It is a non-zero one at rho is equal to zero, okay. So the expression for Ez is given by, okay, Ez is equal to the Bessel function Jn of rho h into the other one, okay. We have written it as E into Q, isn't it? So this is the solution for P and this is the solution for phi. So this is the kind of dependence on rho, radial distance, and this is the kind of dependence on the angle phi. Okay, and this is the z dependence. So this is the solution. Okay, similarly, the expression for hz get and the component other components that is e rho, e phi, h rho, h phi, the transverse components, they can be obtained by substituting these values. They were expressed in terms of ez and hz. So once we know these things, we can find the other components. Other components can be so now the TM and TE waves in a circular waveguide. Okay, is it clear? The procedure is same procedure as that of rectangular waveguide, but the total procedure we have to carry out in cylindrical coordinates because of the geometry. Okay, because of the geometry, and of course expanding Maxwell's equations in cylindrical coordinates and getting the wave equation in cylindrical coordinates and getting the solution for the wave equations in cylindrical coordinates is somewhat more complicated as compared to that of the rectangular waveguide. And normally we use, in most of the cases, we use rectangular waveguides only, okay. Very rarely the cylindrical waveguides are used, okay, only in some special specific applications only cylindrical waveguides are used. Otherwise, mostly the rectangular waveguides are only used, okay. The advantage with rectangular waveguide is the polarization, okay, of the wave will not change, will not get rotated, okay. If you have vertical polarization, the same thing will continue throughout. But because of the circular symmetry of the circular waveguide, okay, in the case of a circular waveguide, the polarization, that is the direction of the electric field vector, okay, will rotate, can rotate if there is any disturbance, okay. That is the reason why we normally don't prefer circular waveguide and we generally use only the rectangular waveguides, okay. Okay, so now we can also here also we can classify the modes into TE modes and TM modes. Okay, so the possible solutions can be divided into TM and TE modes. Okay, for TM, HZ is equal to 0, and the boundary conditions says that EZ must vanish at the surface of the guide. Okay, as I just explained, EZ component will be tangential to the wall. So at rho is equal to, if a is the radius of the guide. Okay, so when rho equal to a, then rho equal to a, we have the boundary. Okay, metallic boundary, wall of the waveguide. So the boundary condition says that EZ must vanish at the surface of the guide. Okay, so that is at rho equal to a, where a is the radius of the guide, this Jn of HA must be equal to 0 to satisfy that boundary condition. To make the field vanish, Jn of HA must be equal to 0. So there is an infinite number of possible TM waves. Okay, so for different values of HA, because I said this Hn is an oscillatory function, so it crosses the zero axis a number of times for different values of the argument. Okay, so like in the TEMNR, our rectangular case, here also there is an infinite number of possible TM waves corresponding to the infinite number of roots of this equation. Roots means where this function becomes zero. Okay, for different values of HA, this function becomes zero. All those values of HA are the roots of this equation. Okay, so as such, but then how many modes will propagate, what modes will propagate, which mode will propagate first? Okay, so that is the thing. Now that depends upon this HA value, that depends upon the HA value. So as before, we have this equation, H square is equal to gamma square plus omega square mu epsilon. So for H square less than omega square mu epsilon, and for H square, this thing for transmission to occur, we require this condition to be satisfied for the transmission to occur. Okay, for the wave to propagate. Otherwise, if this is greater than this one, there will be attenuation of the wave, no propagation takes place. Okay, that is the that corresponds to the cutoff frequency. Okay, H must be smaller. Okay, if suppose if H is large, okay, then okay, if this has to be small than this one, omega must be large. Okay, if omega is small, that means if the signal has to propagate at a somewhat lower frequency, the value of H must be less than that particular value. Okay, so therefore H must be small, otherwise extremely high frequencies are required for propagation to happen. Okay, so only the first few roots of equation 10. So because of this reason, okay, though it can take infinitely large number of values, but all the higher values are of no interest. We need not to bother about them. Only the smaller values of the first few roots of the of this equation only will be useful to us. Okay, will be considered, will have practical utility or practical interest. Okay, so if you see the first few roots, HA01, okay, that is 2.405, then HA02 5.52, and HA11 is 3.85, okay, and HA12 is 7.02. So like that you have the different HA values corresponding to the different roots. Okay, for all these values of HA, the function becomes zero. Okay, so now you can see. Okay, so for example, okay, j naught of rho, this is one root and this is another root and this is another root and this is another root. Similarly, j1 of rho, okay, this is the first one, okay, and then this is one root and then this is another root and like that, okay. These are the different roots, okay, of these things, okay. Okay, so the first subscript refers to the value of n, okay. The first subscript refers to the value of n and the second refers to the roots, okay, in their order of magnitude, okay, in their order of magnitude. So these TM waves, now this is the case for T, we are considering the TM case. So these TM waves will be referred to as a TM01, TM12, okay, and TM11, okay, TM01, TM11, TM12, TM02, and so on, okay. Like that they will be designated corresponding to the root number, okay. Now, for propagation, beta nm, okay, beta nm of the mnth mode, rm, okay, for the propagating wave, this is the condition, okay. So, the cutoff for critical frequency below which transmission of a wave does not occur, that is fc of an by this one, or hnm is equal to this one, okay. So these are the equations. So fc and hnm, the phase velocity, okay, that is omega by theta, that is given by this expression. Now the expressions for TM waves in circular waveguide, you can write like that. For the TM waves, what are the fields that are going to be there? So ez dash will be there, hz will be zero, so ez will be there, h rho will be there, h phi is there, and E rho and E phi. These are the components in general, okay, for the TM case. Okay, for the specific case TM01 or TM11, then what are the fields that will exist? We can find out from these things. And Z and time variations are like this. Suppose this should be multiplied by Z variation and time variation. That gives the total field, okay. So this Jn dash, of course, in this, that indicates the derivative. With reference to H, okay. So anyway, similarly for the transverse electric waves, okay, Ez will be zero, then you call it a transverse electric. Again, similarly, the same procedure we have to follow, and then because Ez is zero, you evaluate Hz, and Hz of course is tangential, so you cannot directly apply the boundary condition on Hz, and then so you have to find out the tangential electric field and apply the boundary conditions and evaluate, and you get the fields like that, okay. And in this case, the boundary condition to be met is E phi is equal to zero at rho is equal to a, okay. And similarly the other one is E phi, okay. So the boundary condition requires that Jn dashed H A is equal to in equation 17. These are the first two roots of the 17 equation. Are like that, okay, and the corresponding TE waves are referred to as TE01 and TE11 and so on. Of course, the other equations for cutoff frequency beta, lambda, g, and phase velocity are identical to those for the TE waves, okay. So, these are the field. Patterns, field lines, electric and magnetic. Radial is the solid line is electrical and the dotted line is magnetic for the different patterns. EM01 the field pattern is like this, okay? And this is from, when you see from this side, and this is the cross section, okay? In the cross section, the TE01 wave is like this, okay? So these fields will be like that. Now in this case, as far as the TM mode is concerned, TM01 is having the lowest cutoff frequency. As far as the TM mode is concerned, TM01 will have the lowest cutoff frequency, whereas TE modes are concerned, as far as is the mode which has the lowest cutoff frequency. Hence, this is what is, this becomes the dominant mode in the case of circular waveguide. In the case of circular waveguide, this becomes the dominant mode. Okay. I hope the things are clear to you now. Okay. So I will stop my presentation here, and planar transmission lines we will take up in the next class. Okay. So I hope I could make at least the circular waveguide clear to some extent. Is this clear? Okay. So rectangular waveguide and circular waveguide. The use of circular waveguide is somewhat limited, and more widely used is the rectangular waveguide at microwave frequencies. Okay. And for all practical purposes, okay, for all practical purposes, the TE10 mode, which is the dominant mode, which is having the lowest cutoff frequency, or in a given guide, the mode which starts propagating first, okay, the signal will travel in the form of TE10 mode first, and then only other modes will come depending upon the frequency, if the guide permits, if the guide dimensions permit. So normally what we do is, we design the guide, okay? We choose the dimensions A and B in such a way that in the frequency range of interest, in the frequency range of interest, only the TE10 mode only will propagate. Other higher modes will not propagate in that particular range. Okay, in that particular guide. So you choose the dimensions A and B in such a way that in your frequency range of interest, only the dominant mode propagates. This is very, very important. So all other parameters of the dominant mode only we are interested, because we permit only that particular mode. So you try to summarize all the equations, okay? You try to summarize all the equations for the dominant mode. In a rectangular waveguide, the TE10 mode is the dominant mode, okay? Okay, where one refers to the off-cycle variation, off-period variation of the field along the A dimension and N, okay? M and N, TEMN, okay? N refers to the off-cycle variation of the field along the narrow dimension. Okay, so you take this also as homework, and you on a piece of paper, on a paper, okay, on a single page, you try to summarize all the equations, that is equation for the cutoff frequency, cutoff wavelength, guide wavelength, beta, the phase velocity, etc., etc., impedance, all these expressions for the TE10 mode, you try to summarize and try to remember all those equations. That is very important. And you try to plot the field patterns for the TE10 mode. Once you do this, things will become very clear to you. Okay? Things will become very clear to you. And very simple expressions will be there for the 10 mode. It will be very easy to remember. It will be very easy to remember. Okay, say for a rectangular waveguide, okay, what is the direction of electric field? Electric field is vertical like this. That is a E by component. Okay, you will have only E by component and you will have Hx component. That's all. And then you have the Hz component. What is the variation of E by component? It will have a sine variation. It is a sine function. Okay, it will be zero at this wall, zero at this wall. That's all. So E by simply you can say, okay, some magnitude, say E naught into sine of m pi by a into x into sine m, m also you need not, m is 1. So simply pi x by a. That is the expression for the E by. And what is the expression for H by? E by and H by, Hx. Okay, they are related through the transverse components, they are related through the impedance looking into the Z, ZTE10. What is the expression for ZTE10? Okay, so Hx is equal to E by, okay, magnitude E by divided by ZTE10. So it will also have the same sine pi x by a. That's all. Okay, so these things if you remember, it would be very convenient for you to understand the design of microwave components. All microwave components except the microwave oven, okay, except the microwave oven, all other microwave components, okay, we assume the propagation of dominant mode only, and considering the properties of that particular mode only, we design the microwave components. Whether you design a matched load or a directional coupler or a T-junction, whatever you design, okay, or a filter or whatever you design, you assume that only TE10 mode is propagating, and to suit that particular mode only, the properties of that particular mode only you will design. So all the design of all microwave components, okay, we consider only the TE10 mode only, and hence the expressions for the TE10 mode or the behavior of the TE10 mode, okay, must be very clear to you to understand the remaining part of microwave engineering. Okay, am I clear? Is it clear to you? Okay. Okay, then shall we close this session? Okay. Right. Thank you.